Christian Audio presents Life in the Presence of God, Practices for Living in Light of Eternity by Kenneth Boa. Narrated by John N. Gully. Dedication. In Conformed to His Image, I wrote that private prayer consists of mental prayer, meditation and contemplation, colloquy, conversational prayer with God, and the prayer of recollection, practicing the presence of God. This recollection of God can be habitual or actual. Habitual recollection is analogous to a man's or a woman's love for a spouse or children and does not require an ongoing consciousness. Just as we can form a habitual identity as being a husband, wife, or parent, so we can ask for the grace to form a habitual state of mind as a follower of Jesus Christ. Actual recollection involves the developing habit of turning to God at regular times throughout the course of the day. This is more along the lines of what Brother Lawrence, Frank Laubach, and Thomas Kelly pursued in their quest for a more conscious awareness of God in the routines of everyday life. As I reflected on this dedication for Life in the Presence of God, it became obvious to me that my clearest experience of life in the presence of another person has been with my beloved wife, Karen. Our 5 decades together has been such a rich and profoundly rewarding mutual journey. In a fallen but soul-forming world, this all-encompassing journey necessarily entails places of difficulty and misunderstanding. But the mutuality of covenant love and commitment has weathered these places and enriched our lives together in ways we could have never anticipated. Our love story is Beatrix Potter's The Tale of Pigling Bland, and it ends with the poignant image of Over the Hills and Far Away, an evocative metaphor of our true home. They ran, and they ran, and they ran down the hill, and across a shortcut on level green turf at the bottom, between pebble beds and rushes. They came to the river, they came to the bridge. They crossed it hand in hand. Then, over the hills and far away, she danced with Pigling Bland. Introduction. Stop. Take a deep breath and listen just long enough to see if this is worth considering. What I'm asking you to do will take no more than a second, but it will also take the rest of your life. It won't require you to sign up for a Bible study or commit any block of time to a group of people. You don't have to buy a study guide, unless you want to, or find a babysitter on a Tuesday night. It'll be easy, but at first it may take a lot of discipline until it becomes habit. Then, in many ways, it will become effortless, as natural as breathing. And it will be the most important, most fruitful, most enjoyable thing you do. I'm talking about learning to live in God's presence. It's something I've been learning to do more of lately, so I've written this book as much for myself as for you. And my goal is simple, to learn with you how to practice the presence of God better in every facet of our lives. By practice, I mean discerning and developing habits of awareness of God's presence, if not all day, every day, at least much more often than most of us typically do. The Bible calls this abiding, remaining in Christ, walking with God, or keeping in step with the Spirit. Whatever you want to call it, God's word is clear that it's important. Without abiding in Him, Jesus said, we will accomplish nothing of lasting value. John chapter 15, verse 5. We won't live like God wants us to live. We also won't get what we want out of life. Outside of this book is a great big world all around you. It clamors for every bit of your attention, and usually, because it's loud and incessant, it wins. Christians are often taught that our main line of defense against this clamorous, invasive world is a daily quiet time. If we're disciplined enough to practice this, we usually complete it before leaving our homes in the morning. Then we head out into the rest of our day, having compartmentalized our God life, leaving our Bible and our relationship with Jesus on our desk or bedside table. Sure, it's good to give the first or the last moments of our day to God. But what about the rest of the day? It's so easy for our hearts and heads to end up somewhere else. Is that how God really wants us to live? Is that what He really had in mind when He said He'd give us abundant life? John chapter 10, verse 10. I'm proposing that we take our life with God and our awareness of His presence with us every day, not just into our quiet times, but into our noisy times too, incorporating practices into our lives that help us keep that awareness right in front of us throughout the day, every day. Anyone can do this. This book is for followers of Christ of every age and maturity level. It's for those who consider themselves mature Christians, but who, for whatever reason, have never learned how to abide in Christ. It's for new believers who are just learning what it means to walk with Jesus. And it's for those who want to rekindle an intimacy they once enjoyed with God that has since faded. It's even for people who already feel close to God because, really, none of us is ever finished drawing near to Him, not in this life. As with a relationship with a good friend, there are always new ways of spending time with Him, of drawing closer to Him, no matter how mature we are. I hope I can convince you that becoming more conscious of God's moment-by-moment presence is something you need and can have. It's not something just for super Christians, a category of people that doesn't exist. It's not for the super spiritual or the ultra mature. It's actually an innate capacity that every true follower of Christ has and can cultivate. From the time a person first believes, God puts His Holy Spirit in every believer, and that Spirit is now available to us every second of every day. Romans chapter 8, verse 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, and Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. Most of us live largely unaware of this divine presence, to our own detriment and impoverishment. More than that, we do so at risk of being disobedient to the commands of Jesus. John chapter 15, verses 4 through 8. In many ways, this book is a sequel to my last book, Rewriting Your Broken Story. That book focused on the power of an eternal perspective. This book talks about how to develop that kind of perspective from a practical standpoint. While that book aimed to convince you of the value of an eternal perspective, I hope this book will teach you how to have that kind of perspective so you can realize the eternal longing God has placed in your heart and in every human heart. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. We were made for more than this world, and only when we live with that understanding can we fulfill the true purpose for which God made us. In one sense, only God Himself can give you this perspective, but we can do certain things to make ourselves more open to His working in us and to hearing what He wants to teach us. Those things are what this book is about. Lord of all pots and pans and things. For many people, one writer comes to mind when they hear the phrase, practicing the presence of God. Brother Lawrence. Maybe you've heard of this well-known French man from the 17th century. A poor dishwasher and cook in a monastery kitchen, Brother Lawrence experienced so much peace and joy in God's presence that people were drawn to him. He mentored many during his lifetime. He kept a record of his experiences, and after his death, his thoughts were compiled into a book, The Practice of the Presence of God. This humble man had come to the point of keeping his mind in His holy presence and recalling it as often as he found it wandered from him. He developed a habitual, silent, and secret conversation with the soul of God as he went about his business, which he considered as sacred in as outside of the cathedral. Since his assigned work area was the monastery's kitchen he is best known for this prayer. Lord of all pots and pans and things, make me a saint by getting meals and washing up the plates. Brother Lawrence's deep but simple teaching echoes an earlier tradition of the Benedictine monks of the 5th and 6th centuries. Ora et labora, pray and work. The idea is to work while praying and pray while working. In other words, everything matters to God, and every moment can be devoted to Him. There's no need to separate the sacred and the secular. In fact, we can't separate them. Life simply isn't bifurcated this way. The spiritual and the physical worlds overlap and are integrated. We live in both, and we have to stop thinking of them as two separate parts of our lives. Brother Lawrence isn't the only one who's written on this theme. Thomas R. Kelly and Frank Laubach are two more recent examples that you'll hear about in this audiobook. Reading writers like these and studying their lives can be extremely inspiring and helpful. I've studied many myself and drawn great inspiration and encouragement from them. But there's something I've never really gotten from any of them, at least not in any detail. I've never found any satisfactory answer for this question. How did they do it? How did they maintain such a centered life with Christ so daily at the center of everything they did? How did they offer their lives as a continual sacrifice of praise, seeming to radiate the presence of Christ in mundane things as well as in the midst of huge trials, suffering, even persecution? Was there some secret to their success at being what Hannah Whittle Smith described as souls with happy hearts, able to walk in triumphant indifference through a sea of external trouble? My desire through this book is to resurrect the spirit of Brother Lawrence, along with the spirit of other writers and practitioners of God's presence over 2 millennia of church history, and to explore what it means to follow their example in our own context. My goal isn't to leave you in awe of their lives, but to discover their secrets with you. I want to take what may have been ineffable experiences to them and put words to them, and then learn how to put it into practice ourselves. I hope I can show you how you can be more aware of His presence, no matter what your life is like. And as you become more aware, I hope you'll learn to respond to His voice and His leadings. I pray that this book will be a catalyst for you to grow in intimacy with Him yourself and lead others to do the same. No magic formula. The fact is, it's one thing to aspire to walk closely with God, but it's another to actually do it. None of the saints of the past came to enjoy the abiding presence of God in their lives by default, accident, or magic. There's no pill they took to suddenly develop the sense that Jesus was with them or to learn how to communicate with Him regularly. You and I can just as easily discover what they understood. We can live in the presence of God every day too. And my goal in this book is to provide you with some intensely practical ways to cultivate that kind of life. Some concrete steps, a suite of practices, to help you develop a closer life with Jesus. I must emphasize one thing, though. There's no formula for walking with God. If you were looking for a 5-step plan, you can set this book aside right now. No such plan exists. There are many ways to draw near to God, lots of practices and methods. They'll all have one thing in common. Every single one goes through the person and work of Jesus Christ. Jesus calls Himself the gate, the door, the way. John chapter 10, verses 7 and 9, chapter 14, verse 6. And He makes very clear that a relationship with Him is our only point of entry into this kind of life with God. Some methods I give you may be helpful for you, but not for others, and vice versa. And some may work for a season of your life, but grow stale over time. The goal isn't to find the way to practice God's presence, but to have a number of possible ways, and to keep in mind that they are only means to an end. The ultimate goal is communion with a very real and present God, something, someone we can enjoy in part on earth and will one day enjoy perfectly. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12. One of the greatest practitioners of the way of life I hope to show you was Watchman Nee. Nee was a brilliant young man and a church planter during Mao Zedong's communist takeover of China. Being often sick and knowing he would either die from illness or in a communist re-education camp, Nee felt the Lord calling him to write. So he did, getting as much on paper as he could before his arrest in 1952. Though he planned and organized his writings well, he knew that without the Holy Spirit, no one would really comprehend what living and abiding in Christ means. These words, which he wrote about his own books, speak somewhat prophetically to the way we've learned to scan and skim books in our quest for rapid answers. God, I have discovered, does not do things our way, and much less does he let us do them. We human beings are not to produce perfect books. The danger of such perfection is that a man can understand without the help of the Holy Spirit. But if God gives us books, they will ever be broken fragments, not always clear or consistent or logical, lacking conclusions, and yet coming to us in life and ministering life to us. We cannot dissect divine facts and outline and systemize them. It is only the immature Christian who demands always to have intellectually satisfying conclusions. The Word of God itself has this fundamental character that it speaks always and essentially to our spirit and to our life. I hope you'll hear this book slowly enough to engage the power of the Holy Spirit. I pray that you find practices in it that speak to your spirit and bring you life. In the first part of this book, we'll explore what the Bible has to say about living in God's presence, some of which might surprise you, even if you're already familiar with Scripture. We'll also take a look at some people whose lives were changed by the experience of God's presence. Then, in part two, we'll discover some answers to the how and why of this practice by looking in some unusual places, like the worlds of neuroscience and sport, and through some real-life stories. For additional practices, exercises, and resources, see the companion, A Guide to Practicing God's Presence, available online at ivypress.com and kenboa.org. As you listen, I pray that you draw inspiration as well as conclusions, and that these words will help spur you to find new life in the presence of Christ. Part 1. The Biblical Basis. Chapter 1. The Secret. Abide in me, and I in you. John chapter 15, verse 4. Anne was 97 years old and recovering from hip surgery. She had lived a beautiful life, but she was tired and ready to go home. She stared blankly at the ceiling. "Why, Lord?" she pleaded. "Why am I still here? Isn't it about that time?" She'd been in conversation with the Lord for decades, learning to hear His voice, and His response came quickly and clearly to her. "Anne, I still have something for you. Get out there and look around." Minutes later, Anne grabbed her walker and slowly made her way out of her room into the central gathering room of the senior living center where she was staying. She scanned the faces, mostly women, a few men. Almost all were nodding off to sleep while a sitcom played on the muted television they were circled around. "This is ridiculous," Anne muttered, still in the conversation that had led her here. "At least they could turn on the volume." But then Anne noticed one lady, off to the side, who had gone into a coughing fit. Her hacking pierced the room, where the only other noises were some snoring and an occasional labored breath. "All right, Lord, I get it," Anne silently prayed. There's still more for me to do. Use me, even here. Anne eased over to the coughing lady, touched her back gently, and began to sing an old tune. Soon, two voices were joined in song, belting out lyrics written when these ladies were in their 20s. When they finished every verse, the lady who had been coughing fell silent. A contented smile spread across her aged face. Anne told her about how much God loved her, then edged away. Anne went to each person in the room in similar manner, placing her arm around them tenderly, sometimes just asking about their life stories, but always telling them about the one who loved them most, her Savior. This is a true story, and Anne is a picture of what most of us would probably want to be like if we reach such a ripe old age. She's a picture of the biblical good life described in Psalm 92. The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon, planted in the house of the Lord. They will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green, proclaiming, "The Lord is upright, He is my rock, and there is no wickedness in Him." Psalm 92, verses 12 through 15, emphasis added. I find Anne's story remarkable, not only because she's fulfilling the calling to continue to bear fruit as long as she draws breath, but because of the natural way she entertains an ongoing dialogue with the invisible God. Did you notice that? There's no doubt she's suffering from aches and pains, and is perhaps discouraged by her shrinking sphere of influence in life. But she's still deeply connected to God, aware of His presence wherever she finds herself. She is never alone. Do you want a relationship like that? Would you like to talk to God honestly all day long, no matter where you are or what you're going through? Did you know you can? That is how a Christian life is supposed to be lived, always in His presence. Did you know that He wants that for you? Look at how Anne struggled at first. Every bone in her body probably cried out against the effort. Her soul longed for home. But she looked up to God first, then outward, rather than succumbing to the temptation to give into exhaustion or feelings of uselessness, which would be totally understandable at her age. Anne has spent a lifetime learning, practicing God's presence. She works to overcome distractions, to slow down enough to listen to Him, to conquer the desire in herself to disobey when God calls her to do something. And this practice has led her to a peace that marks her, an ability to keep reaching out to people, and an assurance about her future. Jesus is drawing people to Himself through Anne, loving people through her. She is a visible manifestation of God's presence in others' lives, just as God's presence is manifest in her own. Most of us aren't 97. We have busy lives and too little margin of free time. Maybe we want more of God in our lives in theory, but we don't see how it can happen, nor do we stop and take time to think about it much. Is there a way to have more of God now instead of waiting until we're retired or so overscheduled or exhausted that we're forced to take a break? Do we even want more of Him? What do you want? Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Psalm 37, verse 4. We all have to back up and start here. Ask yourself, what do I want? I mean, what do you really long for? Whatever your answer is, that's what will shape you. The destination you choose will define your journey. Your intention defines your outcomes. The finish line you envision determines the course of your race. You get the picture. You've got to know what you want. So, do you want more of God in your life? Do you want Him to be involved in what you do every day? Or does the thought of that frighten you? Your answer depends on where you are in your relationship with God, what you think about Him, and your level of commitment. We're all in different places, but if the thought of God's closeness makes you afraid, worried maybe that he'll ask you to give up something you're not ready to give up, or that he'll see you for who you really are, that's okay. Lots of people feel this way, and most of us, if we're honest, are hiding some sins or fears in the recesses of our hearts. This can make the idea of total exposure to a perfect and holy God a little scary. But these fears are unfounded if we're believers. They're based on a view of God that doesn't take into account the magnitude of His goodness and love for us. Maybe we don't exactly see Him as an angry tyrant or an easily disappointed parent who's ready to slap us for every wrong move. But most of us aren't fully convinced He loves us that much. Thankfully, He is not all of the things we think He is. God sent Jesus to bring us freedom, to live a full life, to experience joy, to live in His family. He's a loving Father who wants us to curl up beside Him, lean on Him, rest in Him, and realize He already knows all the things we're hiding or holding back from Him anyway. We are His pride and joy, and He wants to help us, to change us in good ways, to give us power to go out and live extraordinary, full, and satisfying lives. Psalm 16, verse 11 says, "In your presence there is fullness of joy, pleasures forevermore." English Standard Version. Do you believe this is true and not just for later, after you die? Do you believe it's possible to experience joy in being with God now, or have you not even thought to hope this could be true? C.S. Lewis is well known among Christian readers. In his book, Surprised by Joy, he detailed how, beginning at a young age, he noticed a longing in his life for something more than this world had to offer. An unsatisfied desire which itself more desirable than any other satisfaction. He explained how memorable these moments were, so much that he even found himself longing for the longing to return so he could try to put a name to it. He didn't come to faith in Christ for a long time afterward. He was a smart loner, isolated by choice, and a devout atheist. But his biographer, Devin Brown, noted that people who knew him after his conversion said his whole life took on a tone of joy, the kind most of us reserve for Christmas and birthdays. In Christ, Lewis found real life, filled with a kind of joy that was different than he could have ever expected, but which also had the familiar sense of those experiences so long before. Lewis explained how he came to understand the difference between what we often pursue and what we really want. Our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures, fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us, like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. In The Joyful Christian, he explains, "Aim at heaven, and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth, and you will get neither." See, we're called to far more than what the world tells us to pursue. The ambitions of this world aren't big enough for eternity. They're not strong enough to sustain us for the long run. The poet George Herbert wrote, "If souls be made of earthly mold, let them love gold. If born on high, let them unto their kindred fly. For they can never be at rest till they regain their ancient nest. Then, silly soul, take heed, for earthly joy is but a bubble and makes thee a boy." Here's the point. The pleasures this world offers are just toys that make us fools and sell us short. We're meant for more. Even our best imaginations of the good life are inadequate. Only God really knows what we're meant for and what we're made to do. Our identity and purpose are revealed in the Bible and understood in relationship with Him. But most of us are so busy with our mud pies that we don't see how much is promised to us in that book. The whole Bible, and especially the teachings of Jesus, talk about the real purpose of life. And it's only by engaging with God's Word that we can begin to understand how to grow and thrive and prosper. Jesus asked a couple of his followers this fundamental question: What do you seek? John chapter 1, verse 38. He wanted to know, what are you really after? Is it me, or is it something you hope to get from me? So let's go back to the question I asked a moment ago. What do you want? What do you see as the good life, the ultimate satisfying life? Whether you believe it or not, the truest satisfaction comes from finding out where Jesus is going, following him, and then staying with him there. John chapter 1, verse 39. Steady the pendulum. In one of his most famous lines, St. Augustine of Hippo wrote, "Thou hast formed us for thyself, and our hearts are restless till they find rest in thee." When your allegiance to God is split with your allegiance to your boyfriend or spouse, your boss or board of directors, or anyone or anything else, you'll find yourself in constant inner turmoil. Restless, like a pendulum, swinging between two extremes, worshiping God sometimes with certain people, and devoted to the priorities and activities the world tells us are important at other times. You'll focus on God in one moment and push him to the back of your mind most of the rest of the time. The Bible talks a lot about an undivided heart, how one true allegiance makes you one whole person. See Psalm 86, verse 11. You're going to have to steady the pendulum and stop swinging if you want to find your center. It's my goal to help you, because what you'll find when you stop swinging is that you've gained more than you've given up. The book of 2 Chronicles tells the story of the new King Solomon, of whom God asked, "What do you really want?" Realizing he didn't have what it took to do the job God just gave him, Solomon asked God for wisdom. When he answered, it was like on a game show when all the bells go ding, 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 and the lights flash. Solomon chose the right answer, and God was so pleased with him that he not only granted Solomon's request, but he gave him everything he didn't ask for too. In essence, God said, "Since this is your heart's desire and you didn't ask for wealth, possessions, or honor, or for me to kill your enemies, or for long life, but instead you asked me for wisdom and knowledge to lead my people, you will get what you asked for, and I will give you everything you didn't ask for too. Wealth, possessions, honor, more than a king has ever had or will ever have again." 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verses 11 and 12, my paraphrase. Under Solomon, the nation of Israel began to fulfill the promise God made to Abraham years before, a nation of people who served a good God in the land he'd given them. For a time, their king was so wise and their lives so good that news of Israel spread throughout the world. I think we miss that we're being made a similar offer. We may not be the king of Israel, but if we're Christians, we're supposed to be leading lives that attract others to Jesus. It's like God is asking us, all the time, to choose what we really want. Do we most want the life he offers, or do we want something else more? Today, there's still only one answer that will make the bells ding and the lights flash. God, in his word, calls us to make a choice and steady the pendulum, to unite our life and world. No more dividing things between what is sacred and what is secular. God doesn't divide the two, and when we try to, the result is a divided, restless, unhappy life. Jesus said we can't serve the world and God too. We cannot serve two masters. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. And he didn't say it without reason. Attempting to serve two masters makes us miserable and unproductive, which is why God and the Bible don't allow it. But how do we pledge our allegiance to God while we're still living in this world? How do we keep from dividing our hearts when we have a foot in two different worlds at once? And how can we commit to the invisible world when we still have responsibilities and plans here on earth? There are people who have mastered this, or are in the middle of mastering it, and we can learn from them. The secret. Some people just seem good at being Christians. They're happy Christians, people who seem to really know God personally, and can talk to Him like a close friend and enjoy their relationship with God. Their lives and character seem infused with a supernatural quality. They're more peaceful, steadier, kinder. They appear to get more accomplished with less work and worry. Have you known anyone like this? We're drawn to these kind of people. They're real, live people, not just the Christian greats like C.S. Lewis, Thomas Merton, A.W. Tozer, Billy Graham, Dwight Moody, Martin Luther King Jr., and Corrie Ten Boom, the list could go on, that we read about in books, but people we've watched and been touched by firsthand. That older couple at church who invites you to their home and explain scripture to you in ways you've never heard before. The friend who drops everything on a busy day just to come over and pray with you. The youth pastor whose front door was always open, so you could hang out with his family when you were going through a rough time with your own. There's a sense of something very real and holy about all of these people. But they're just people, like you and me. There's nothing particularly unique about them except one thing. They've learned a simple secret. The Christian life means life in Christ. The motions of these people's lives may be similar to ours, but because they take Jesus seriously when He says to abide in Him, John chapter 15, there's an entirely different and much sweeter quality to their lives. These people reflect what the extraordinary life of Jesus looks like in an ordinary life. They're fulfilling the great commandments, loving God with all their hearts, souls, minds, and strength, and allowing that love to overflow into the people around them. They're living out these commands imperfectly but faithfully, here and now, one day at a time, not someday. And you and I can too. The key is this: instead of just mentally believing in the gospel of Christ, we need to start living this in Christ life now. We need to become practitioners, not following biblical laws to check a box, but doing practical things to get close to God, like we do with anyone we want to be close to. None of this happens by human effort alone. All of it requires the help of the Holy Spirit, who lives in every believer. As we offer our lives to God through practices that draw us to Him, it may feel less natural at first. Growing close to someone takes time. A relationship doesn't deepen and mature overnight, and there are those awkward moments in the beginning. But if we keep practicing and don't give up, we'll find that time spent cultivating our life in God is worth more than anything else we've ever done. First things. If we want to take this secret and run with it, there are two things we have to do. The first is trust, and the second is train. After this chapter, we'll focus a lot on training, so here we have to talk about trust. Without trust, our training is in vain. Faith in Christ is always the starting line in the race of pursuing God. He's the initiator. He pursues us before we ever begin to pursue Him. But when we respond to Him, surrendering our lives to Him, like a lump of clay surrenders to the artisan at the potter's wheel, then He uses our practice to change us. He does the work of bringing us into His good life, but He needs a willing participant. And in the Bible, the first thing people do to participate with God is trust Him. This trust is non-negotiable. The chance to live with God is a privilege reserved for His children, not something we deserve or can conjure up or control. So, we start with trust. Without it, it's impossible to please God or draw near to Him. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Any effort we make to enter God's presence without faith in His Son will fail. But for those who put their trust in Him, this promise is true. You who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. And through him, we have access to the Father by one Spirit. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 13 and 18. In the Gospels, Jesus tells us to believe in him. The Greek word he uses was pistuo. It implies a transfer of trust and a mutual personal reception. It means taking our trust off of ourselves or someone else and handing it over to Jesus. So to believe in Christ is to embrace him. This idea is radically different from the rest of the religions of the world. In Christianity, we don't trust in our own work to attain, achieve, or merit favor in the next life, or this one either. It's exactly the opposite. God working salvation on our behalf, even when we were still sinners. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. As soon as we transfer trust to Christ, God embarks on his mission to conform us to the image of Christ, making us able to experience life with him now and forever. And he does this in the same way he saved us, by grace through faith. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. So this secret of practicing God's presence starts and ends with trust. And even the best spiritual training program in the world will fail if we don't start there. A single-minded pursuit. Trusting God leads to single-mindedness over time. Jesus, especially in his parables, encouraged his followers to bet the farm on his character, to go for broke when it comes to seeking him. He can't be the first priority among many. He is the priority, or he's no priority at all. As C.S. Lewis said, Christianity is a statement which, if false, is of no importance, and if true, of infinite importance. The one thing it cannot be is moderately important. Too many people see Jesus as moderately important. Especially in America, many who call themselves Christians attend church weekly, or less often, and view 2 hours on a Sunday morning as enough. Jesus to them is a component of their lives. But this mindset is a huge mistake. Jesus is the pearl of great price, the hidden treasure in a field. Real Christianity is throwing everything in for him, dying to self, and following him every day. That's what trust means. It means not just saying we believe the bridge will hold, but proving our trust to be true by stepping out and walking across it. Fellowship with God, not our own satisfaction, has to be the primary goal we pursue. If we pursue satisfaction as an end, we'll never obtain it. It will always elude us. But if we pursue God first, we'll find satisfaction is often a byproduct. This is risky, and it's not always easy, because it requires self-denial. But Jesus never invites anyone to give up something without offering something better. And he promises that if we lose our lives for his sake, we'll find them. But if we try to save our lives, we'll end up losing them forever. Luke chapter 9, verse 24. Loving and trusting God makes us worthy before him. Scottish theologian Henry Scogel said, "The worth and excellency of a soul is to be measured by the object of its love. He who loveth mean and sordid things doth thereby become base and vile, but a noble and well-placed affection doth advance and improve the spirit into a conformity with the perfections which it loves. The true way to improve and ennoble our souls is by fixing our love on the divine perfections, that we may always have them before us, and derive an impression of them on ourselves." We can't put our trust in Christ one time and stop. We have to go on, continually, single-mindedly, trusting and coming and following him the rest of our lives. This commitment is radical and total. It's an absolute surrender, as the South African author Andrew Murray called it. It demands our all. But this total commitment is an accumulation of many small commitments to practice his presence, to live in Christ every moment. And making the most of those small moments is what this book is about. Amphibious. Frank Laubach was an American missionary in the Philippines who learned by practice the value of making the most of small moments. He and his wife had moved to the Philippines early in their marriage with a dream of working among the Moro, a people known as the worst troublemakers American soldiers had ever faced. The Moro people were Muslims with a four-century track record of resisting foreign rule, and their long, armed conflict with the American military had ended just a year before. The Laubachs felt called to reach these people. No mission field was ever so untrodden or so in need. But the military forbade it. Young, inexperienced preacher teachers had no business there. So the Laubachs settled for work in other parts of the Philippines, even as they held on to their dream to reach the Moros. After 14 years in the Philippines, Frank was finally allowed to enter Donsalon, where the Moro lived, but he found them totally resistant to his teaching. One day, completely discouraged, he climbed a hill behind the cottage where he was staying. He sat and tearfully poured his heart out to God. "I hate myself. My plans have all gone to pieces." Then he begged God to come and work through him. God showed him that he'd been acting like he was superior because he was a white, literate American. He immediately asked the Muslim religious leaders to teach him about what they believed, and his mission field opened up. Frank found ways to reach them that he'd never thought of before. The hill behind his home became Laubach's place of ongoing conversation with God. Wanting even more, Laubach made a great experiment that year of first trying to think of God every 15 minutes while he worked, or at least every half hour, and eventually trying to think of God 1 second of every minute. It sounds impossible, but by the end of that year, it had become his habit, so much a habit that he continued it for the rest of his life. In his diary, which was later published as Letters by a Modern Mystic, Laubach explains how adjusting his thinking this way took some effort at first, but became completely natural. And it empowered him, revolutionized his life and ministry, because he was every single minute with God. Laubach said it was pretty clear that this was what Jesus was doing all day, every day. It's also clear, he said, that it's not what most of his followers have been doing. In his book, The Game with Minutes, he said that people who practice these things experience the same world as the rest of us, yet they see it has a new glorious color and a far deeper meaning. Laubach was right that this is how Jesus lived. Christ was in constant communication with the Father, and he intended for us to learn this from him. The Bible makes clear we were designed to live in two worlds at once, the one we were born into and the one into which we've been born again, John chapter 3. That world most of us rarely visit is more real than the one clamoring for our attention. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. It's the world where he promised we'd be able to go in and out freely and find good pasture. John chapter 10, verse 9. Jesus wasn't speaking nonsense. He was talking about the very thing Laubach was doing. In a letter to his father, Laubach wondered if everyone could actually do this. Can a laboring man successfully attain this continuous surrender to God? Can a man working at a machine pray for people all day long, talk with God all day long, and at the same time do his task efficiently? Can a merchant do business? Can an accountant keep books, ceaselessly surrender to God? Can a mother wash dishes, care for the babies, continuously talking to God? Can little children be taught to talk and listen to God inwardly all day long? And what is the effect upon them? Briefly, it is a thing which the entire human race might conceivably aspire to achieve. The answer is that everyone can become aware of God in this way. And if everyone did, the results would be evident and the life of Christ more visible in all of his followers. Why so few churches talk about this is a mystery to me. We seem to think we have to wait until we die to experience the invisible world. But Jesus clearly didn't think so. Otherwise, why would he say, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock"? Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Jesus is no fool. He doesn't stand at a door that won't open until we die. He's standing at your door, waiting for you now. The gate between these two worlds is Jesus, and if you've trusted your life to him, the gate is open. Great Christians know this kind of living. C.S. Lewis said that humans are sort of amphibious beings. Frogs are amphibious because they can survive on land or in water. They're able to live in the water, but they can also hop on land. We're not amphibious from a biological standpoint, but we are from a spiritual one. Like frogs, we live in one world while belonging to another. We can be with the God of heaven while our feet are planted firmly on earth. A lot of us live as if there's a God world and a separate material world. We develop a sort of sacred-secular dichotomy, keeping the two worlds separate in our mind and practice. But we weren't made to live like this. God hardwired us to grasp both worlds simultaneously. He set eternity in the human heart. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. The visible and the invisible are both real, and they're not separate. They're integrated, and when our lives reflect this fact, we become more the people God intends for us to be. We can train ourselves to embrace our amphibious nature. We can train our hearts and our minds to discern the eternal, invisible, transcendent things of God at the same time as we're engaged in the immediate and visible world. As we bring the extraordinary into our ordinary lives, God's splendor into our mundane routines, we thrive. And as in Laubach's life, it will bring us a vitality we will surely notice in ourselves, and others will notice it too. This is the practice of living in Christ. It's how Christians have endured persecution and found joy in unlikely circumstances. It's the difference between a happy Christian and one who doesn't seem very much like Christ at all. It's not an impossible life. It's an eminently possible life when Christ is in us. And it's the life we all long for, whether we recognize it or not. Listen to God in His Word. Read John chapter 15, verse 5 a few times through, and then write it down. Keep it with you in your pocket, or your wallet, or a place where you'll see it all the time. Try to recall it throughout the day and say it as a prayer that you've personalized, something like this: "Without you, Lord, I can't do anything. Please let me abide in you." Practice His presence. Your game with minutes. Listen again to this chapter to see what I said about the secret to life in the presence of God. Then listen to how Frank Laubach brought himself more into the presence of God, at first every hour and then every minute. Consider reading his Letters by a Modern Mystic, as it gives more detail. Put your own spin on this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.